Thank you so much. Thank you, Jorinda and Jort, for inviting me and for organizing, and to the Rietveld Academy for having me. I'm very happy to be here with you today. I will show work, some of which I will speak about explicitly, and some of which will run in the background. So in the beginning, you will see some slides from the Momenta Biennale, which I just curated, so these photos are fresh off the press, so to speak. If you have questions about these works that I'm not addressing explicitly, or any of the other works, feel free to just ask me. The ocean is always outside until it floods your home or exhibition space. The current climate catastrophe does not halt at any boundaries established during the Holocene and promoted in Western modernity. Temperatures do not stay relatively stable. Sea levels rise and overflow countless demarcations of land, while other areas perish in drought. Land dwellers' feet get wet, sparing neither Kiribati nor Miami nor Venice. The turmoiled nature cultures, as the feminist philosopher Donna Haraway calls the entangled and inseparable syntheses of nature and culture, muddle any attempts at expelling nature as a supposed outside, which can be shut out and its effects ignored. As the realization that an outside does not exist also seeps into the global north, attempts at separating humanity from nature are becoming ever more futile. It is important to note that those who can afford it still try to segregate themselves, as usual, while others literally have to flee for survival. The oceanic Anthropocene is unevenly distributed, caused by some parts of humanity more than by others, and affecting some humans and non-humans more than others. Pointedly, the Métis scholar Zoe Todd highlights the necessity to go beyond the current framings of the Anthropocene as it, and I quote her here, "It blunts the distinctions between the people, nations, and collectives who drive the fossil fuel economy and those who do not," end of quote. Other terms for the Anthropocene that have been proposed are capitalocene, plantationocene, stulocene, but neither of those really fully capture this moment and space either. And so throughout my talk today, I will continue to use the word Anthropocene in lack of a better term as of yet. In our current political, cultural, and geologic circumstances that unsettle what was previously ostensibly fixed, uncertainty and change overflow tales of teleology, stability, and linear history. These demand different tools to make sense of the world, and these kinds of tools, as well as our realization that our previous certainties are changing, may also change our very epistemologies. And so in my curatorial work, I ask what forms of curating are more apt to respond to the Anthropocene rather than the Holocene, and in fact, what forms of curating actually come out of the Anthropocene. And the same is true for art making. What forms of art making come out of not the Holocene, but the Anthropocene? The uneven and uncontainable climate crisis obligates both curators and artists to rethink our ways of working. Exhibition making and art making in times of ecological disaster and with the effects of ongoing colonial capitalism palpable on a planetary scale need to differ from previous curatorial and artistic modes. The oceans are an ample metaphor, material and method to think through these questions. The oceans consist of generative processes that store, dissolve, and merge old and new questions. And Jorinda mentioned that the oceans store memories that have been suppressed. And I'm very interested in the oceans and their materialities for that reasons. Diving into their watery depths, we may find ways to perpetually reconfigure our multifaceted understandings of countless worlds. So the oceanic Anthropocene requires both new and ancient ways of being in the world, both for living but also for making art. In recent years, the ocean has seeped into a great number of artists' works. This interest in the Earth's hydrosphere is due to the important role that the oceans play for our planetary climate, but also the philosophical, ethical, and aesthetic possibilities that a water world, water-based worldview presents. The artists I'm speaking about today work through poetry and through smells, moving image, installation, performance, and many other media. They swim with the ocean's connective ripples, and they listen to songs of aquatic mammals and to the stories of humans buried underneath the waves. I should say that I don't intend this lecture to be a list or that it, I intend it to be complete in any way, but I invite you to consider it as a personal journey alongside the works of artists and thinkers that I keep returning to in my work. Curating and making art in an oceanic way is neither limited to nor defined by artworks or exhibitions addressing the oceans explicitly, but is composed of methodologies that are hybrid, transdisciplinary, generative, fluid, uncertain, and transformative, that work at different temporal and spatial scales, and that involve various forms of knowledge, both human and non-human. The ocean provides a model to accommodate change and unpredictability, to sway back and forth between them, and ultimately to transcend numerous disciplines and invoke performativity, both in the exhibition-making process and in the audience experience. And exhibitions and artworks that proceed from oceanic thinking can provide fora to inspire new ways of thinking, feeling. Specifically, I suggest that Tidalectics, a term and concept coined by the late historian and poet Kamau Brathwaite, who sadly passed away last year, can provide precious guidance for an oceanic artistic project. I'm showing you now some images from an exhibition that I curated in 2017. Which took cues from Kamau Brathwaite's thinking, Tidalectics. And I curated it at the TBA 21 Augarten in Vienna, and from there traveled to the Frenois in Tourcoing, France, as well as to the Museum of Modern Art in Dubrovnik, Croatia. Tidalectics is a play on words composed of the dialectics that Brathwaite believes define Western thinking, and tides, so it's a composite word, tidalectics. And the word proposes that the tides are what defines, or that we should focus much more on the tides than on the dialectics or the sort of fixity and staticness that Western dialectics, according to Kamau Brathwaite, have defined. And whereas socially engaged and interdisciplinary curatorial and artistic practices emerged in the 20th century, tidalectic curating and art making, as I have developed a concept and methodology in the past years, is different in that it takes its primary inspiration from a natural phenomenon, and it performatively engages with the social and ecological structures of the system in which it operates. Brathwaite introduced tidalectics in his poetry, not merely by outlining it, but by performing it. So he deploys palimpsests, unusual syncopations, and omitted syllables to invoke the incessant, irregular, and generative movement of the waves. He asserts that English, the language of the colonizers in his native Barbados, is not appropriate for the Caribbean colonial and diasporic experience. He writes, "The hurricane does not roar in pentameters." And yet, Brathwaite's writing elicits how the Caribbean context cannot be unthought from colonialism and its trajectory across the Atlantic, of both colonizers arriving to the islands and slaves who were abducted and exploited on sugarcane plantations. I would like to read you a passage here. like the movement of the ocean she's walking from, coming from one continent continuum, touching another, and then receding, reading from the islands into the perhaps creative chaos of their future. And here's another section from his writing. It takes me back and drags me tidalectic into this tangled urgent meaning to and fro, like foam, swordless at the bottom of the sea, dragging our meaning, our moaning song from Calabar along the sea floor, with pebbles sound and conch and wound and sea sound moon. So in this passage, the movement of water and bodies towards and from the shore is tangled and cannot be thought apart, nor can it be separated from the middle passage. Rietveld evokes a form of being and thinking emerging performatively from his postcolonial context. And I use the word performative in the sense of what the gender studies scholar Eve Kosofsky-Sedrick calls a strategy for the production of meaning and being relating to affect. In Tidalectics, bodies, water, and meaning are intertwined and move together. When carefully transferred to the artistic context while acknowledging its specificity and roots within postcolonial Caribbean experience, Tidalectics is particularly productive for approaching climate change as it dissolves ostensible certainties. In Rietveld's thinking and writing, uncertainty does not equate a frightening realization, undoing a privileged sense of self, as it so often does in the global north, but a point of departure. Rietveld reminds readers that hybridization is a ubiquitous process promoted by the oceans and that maritime spaces connect rather than divide. Tidalectics, if breathed into artistic work, helps sustain fluidity as well as encounters between the known and the unknown. The unknown then is not merely integrated into an established framework, but along with the known creates a third space, a hybrid, collective, and mutual becoming that thinks and makes together with other species and their surroundings. Tidalectics allows for seeing things in a more holistic, if always partial, situated way. Similarly, ecological issues need to be seen in connection with their wider ramifications and reverberations. Pollution turns water toxic, and higher temperatures cause algae to bloom, blocking out sunlight and causing whole areas of oceans to become unlivable for fish, and as a consequence also affecting the livelihoods of humans. Neglect injures, and care helps the ocean to thrive. In ecology as well as in politics, art making, and curatorial practice, more nuanced understandings of these holistic relations are needed. Such nuance does not need to dampen urgency, but it is necessary in order to connect details at a larger, if always tentative, whole. Every wave breaks differently, and with their different forms, each affects neighboring waters in a specific way. As Rietveld points out, human and non-human histories are shaped by these waves and their specificity. I would now like to introduce two examples for how I think, feel, and work with tidalectic methodologies. So one example, for an important project, I believe, for artistic research, looking in particular into deep sea extractivism. In the exhibition that I called Tidalectics, an homage to Kamau Rietveld, of which I've been showing you images here, I set out to explore a fluid curatorial framework in which not only did each iteration of the traveling exhibition change, but also within each iteration, there were variations to the extent that visitors experienced a different exhibition on each day, or in fact, even during the days when they visited. Jana Winderen's sound installation, which is difficult to depict because it's a sound work, but here is an installation view of the overall exhibition. Jana Winderen's sound work called Bara from 2017 was composed from hydrophone recordings that the artist collected during various journeys, among others with TBA 21 Academy, where I was a curator previously. Jana traveled from the North Pole to the Caribbean and the Pacific Oceans recording with her hydrophone. The composition that she created comprised diverse sounds from waves to the distinctive clicking noise of crustaceans, smaller fish species grunting, and larger mammals like cetaceans. The ocean's ecosystems are extremely sensitive to sound pollution, and the sonic level of an underwater environment can be indicative of the health of marine habitats. The installation in the exhibition was only audible during some times of the day, namely at the moments when the tide at in Trieste, which is the closest coast to Vienna, was either at its very highest or very lowest point. And this fluctuation acted as a way to account for the ever-changing tides and to go beyond the rigidity of temporal and spatial scales that are common in exhibition contexts and also in much of the Western world. This curatorial decision necessitated that other works that were included in the exhibition and that had sound, such as installations by Eduardo Navarro, which you saw on previous slides, Susanne Winterling, who I'll be speaking about in a moment, and also an installation by Emkal Eyongakpa, which you can see here, were turned off to allow listeners to focus on Jana Winderen's audio piece. So Brathwaite's term Tidalectics originates in the Caribbean, joining the Pacific and the Atlantic Ocean, that formed a liquid subfloor for the history of migration of the past 500 years. A history, however, extending its roots into distant waters many millennia ago. This interconnectedness, the web network of what Paul Gilroy refers to as the Black Atlantic, and I quote him here, between the local and the global, challenges the coherence of all narrow nationalist perspectives. Ocean voyages and migrations were the pivot of Emkal Eyongakpa's work, and his installation destabilized the ground under visitors' feet. The moving floor was accompanied by a sound work, as well as by fishing nets swinging back and forth over visitors' heads. And these fishing nets were filled with debris found by beachcombers, as well as personal objects of oceanic travelers from voluntary voyages, as well as to forced migrations. Connected by water and maritime ties, the movements of people, animals, goods, and ideas transcend the biographical and point to global webs of power and solidarity. In like manner, the Tongan Fijian writer and anthropologist Epeli Hau’ofa, in his book Our Sea of Islands, which was first published in 1993, offers a more holistic perspective in which things are seen in the totality of their relationships. Epeli Hau’ofa was an important person to critique the derogatory and belittling views of indigenous cultures, outlining the lasting negative effects that these exert on people and their connections to their histories and traditions. His voice plays a pivotal role in reversing the notion of Oceanian small island developing nations, so tiny crumbs of land in a sea somewhere divided from one another and from everything else, to that of large ocean nations. So Hau’ofa overthrows the idea that the ocean is something which divides, but says instead that the ocean is that which connects. And the shift of perspective prompts new possible outlooks on culture, economy, and political autonomy beyond narrow deterministic views. His writing also reminds us of the epic myths, oral traditions, and cosmologies of Oceania, a prodigious world that has unjustly been rendered as tiny and deficient in resources as a condition of colonial definement. Newell Harry's work in the exhibition showed how exchange and travel have occurred via the ocean for millennia. Harry charts the Creole and Pidgin languages, alternative modes of exchange, and notions of value and currency in the Pacific. The exhibition featured two of his works, which are depicted here. One of them employs the kula ring, a traditional system of ceremonial gift exchange, and the other one is composed of anagrams printed on hereditary Tongan ngatu cloths. Ngatu is a fabric obtained from the bark of trees, initially for making clothing, and still used in formal occasions today. These cloths are passed down from one generation to the next, and similar to the cooler objects, they acquire value and meaning due to provenance. Newell Harry, who has traveled extensively in the South Pacific, prints four-letter terms on these organic banners, juxtaposing words like Kula with R2-D2 and Goya with the anagram yoga, resulting in a potpourri of references from diverse contexts that span Pacific geographies, art history, and popular culture. Harry's play on words resonates with Kamau Brathwaite's fluid language, and I say again here, the hurricane does not roar in pentameters. Susanne Winterling's installation, Glistening Troubles, resulted from her residency at the Alligator Head Foundation in Jamaica. The work investigates the bioluminescence of dinoflagellate algae as indicators for health of coastal waters with toxic potential. So for several years, Susanne's research has homed in on these organic bodies that light up when touched or moved. So when a boat, for example, passes through water, or if a swimmer passes through water, these algae light up. You may have seen images or videos. It's beautiful. Susanne thinks of these algae as analogous to touch screens. So these computer-generated, computer-generated imagery in reference to the imagery that surrounds us every day. They're enlarged individual algae, which transform scale and temporality, and they blur the borders also between what we consider nature and culture. Part of the work is a video interview with a fisherman called Jerry, who Winterling filmed during her residency. And the interview grants insight into the medicinal properties of the algae that have been known to people living on the shore for a long time, and they're actually used to treat skin diseases. So here there's again a connection to the touch screen or to this idea of our skin being the interlocutor between ourselves and this other being, in a similar way to the interfaces of our digital touch screens, which allow us access to digital realities. Another part of the work were mirror columns, which were interspersed between various monitors, and they became almost like corporeal agents. Visitors could mirror themselves in them and became part, in a way, of the installation. There was also this phenomenon of viewing and masking in a way similar to what we see in, you know, film editing virtual worlds. And so Susanne's work really delves into questions of solidarity and our vibrant entanglement with other bodies, or what Karen Barat calls having the other in one's skin. The curatorial methodology of the exhibition largely occurred while we were traveling on a boat, which is owned by the TBA 21 Academy Foundation. And the boat is a site of cultural production, inviting artists, scientists, and other thinkers and practitioners from various parts of the world, including the areas that are visited on each trip. And these voyages have led to many different geographies, and many of the projects that were in this exhibition resulted from residencies by artists on this boat and from having the opportunity to really spend time together and really go into depth and discuss together for a long time. The exhibition, in my view, was also tidalectic because it was not fixed and it responded to a naturally occurring phenomenon, the tides. It was relational and responsive, or in the words of Donna Haraway, attempting to be responsible, enabling shared and mutually affecting responses to bring about new capacity and new capacities of agency and ethics. The exhibition was an attempt to turn and immerse ourselves, even if we're staying dry for now, in the water covering our planet, where movement and flux prevail over static halts. Each of the artists engaged in their own particular ways with the diverse questions emerging from the archipelago of cultural, political, and biological predicaments. From ancestral myths to so-called modern science, fiction, poetry, and interspecies communication. So Tidalectics attempted at a moment of time when the oceans seep more and more into our worlds because of rising sea levels, or rather when an oceanian awareness of the ocean, which has existed in Oceania for millennia, at this moment when these kinds of ways of thinking and doing seep more and more into the global north, Tidalectics attempted to offer tools to think through these dissolving notions of time and of space, blurred divisions between land and water, and the coalescing human and more than human relationships to dive together into a sea of possible futures. We made a book as well, which was important to have something to share beyond our own geography. This book was, among other things, distributed to the places where we traveled. My second example I want to introduce to you today includes, or responds perhaps more directly to this kind of holistic perspective that Kamau Brathwaite urges us to see. In August last year, I curated the ocean section of the exhibition Down to Earth at the Gropius Bau as part of the Berliner Festspiele. The show took inspiration from the sociologist Bruno Latour's 2017 publication of the same title, engaging, in Latour's words, the earth with its thousand folds. The exhibition worked without any use of electricity, no air conditioning, no artificial light, no video works were part of the exhibition. Travel for the install was reduced as much as possible and mostly occurred only by train. And performers were playing unplugged. Many artists had to reconceive their works specifically for the exhibition. And the institution also made public its carbon emissions and a plan to address them in the future. So I won't go into so many details here, but I thought it was a very interesting model and believe that even though some of this is still very gestural and needs to be researched further, it is one way to begin thinking about our own implication in questions of ecology. So the works in the exhibition highlighted different aspects of the ocean from the Black Atlantic to contemporary migration and submarine cables. They were also poetic. Himali Singh Soin's poem Boatness juxtaposed aquatic natural phenomena with a human-created vessel or a bearer of emotions, and I'm going to read you a part here. The boat is after the ark. It can tell big things from far away as if it always saw love coming. The strong post of the eye, the fragile bend of the T, love breaking, as if it knew it had made a promise it could not keep. So in the poem, the rocking boat becomes a metaphor for the moving body. And together with her partner, the musician David Soin Tapeser, Himali turned the poem into a score that could be performed by multiple people distributed across the planet at different times and in different ways. Evaporating permafrost, for instance, could be conducted by a clock or by an analog orchestra. With the spatial and temporal fragments of the poem activated by bodies and activating bodies who perhaps will never meet, the work defied attempts of ever fully grasping the ocean while pointing to its transcendence through history and geography. The gender studies and environmental scholar Astrida Neimanis beautifully considers water as an incomplete, queer, archive of feeling that both retains and dissolves. And I think of Boatness as an open-ended and processual project, similar to Neimanis's queer archive of feeling. With its emphatic, distinctive rhythms, Boatness conjures the passing of time at sea, the love of seaweed, and the spirit of the waterborne vessel. Cecil Tolas has worked with smells for a decade, collecting, synthesizing, cataloging, and recomposing them. Smell, similar to sound, cannot be depicted, so I have here an image of Jean Painlevé one of the early underwater photographers who we also included in the exhibition. For the installation Ocean Smellscapes, Cecil Tolas collected molecules at three different places in Costa Rica, which is one of the most species places on the planet. And she diffused the smells at the moments when the tide in Warnemünde, again the closest coast to Berlin, was at its highest and respectively lowest point. So in my curatorial practice, I try to support artists working with research, but at the same time, I really believe that the aesthetic dimension of work is incredibly important and that research needs to transpire not only through vision. And this is because the optics-focused paradigm is too tightly knit with distanced extractivist attitudes that ignore and seek to eliminate non-Western and embodied forms of sense-making. Smell activates the same parts of the brain where emotions are registered and where memory is stored. And so it is a form of knowing for which we have less words than, for example, for vision or for taste, but it is still very important and really smell is a very effective way of knowing. And so the ocean, I believe, can teach us to trust our senses and to consider smell, among other things, as a way of knowing. Miriam Simon's work, Your Urge to Breathe is a Lie, consists of instructions that invite participants to perform science fictional collective training to come closer to the body and psyche of a cephalopod, so an inkfish, for example. With the regimen, Simone attempts to learn the embodied cognition, shapeshifter capabilities, and distributed intelligence of squids and octopuses. Practiced with a group of performers to create a shared body with the aim of overcoming modernist European ideals of independence, the work considers these oceanic creatures as role models while embracing the possibilities existing within the human biological system. In the words of the gender studies scholar Eva Hayward, and I quote her here, "All of us are partly coral reefs full of developing polyps, growing sponges, brooding anemones, and feeding sea snails," end of quote. With these training principles, Miriam Simon's speculatively advocates for non-human ways of being and knowing for the project of shared wet futures. The last project that I will present today is Prospecting Ocean, a close collaboration between myself and the artist Armin Linke. We worked together for 3 years actually on this project. And with this project as a starting point, I also wrote a book in which I think about Armin's own work, but also draw in other artists' works to think about ocean extraction. And I will tell you about this project because I really think it's a quite useful case study for how artistic research can grapple with the difficulties of naming, representing, and rethinking complex issues that cannot be tackled by a single discipline. Prospecting Ocean addressed the imminent threat of deep sea mining. Deep sea mining aims to extract minerals from the seabed, which are needed to produce phones, but also technologies based in renewable energies. The mining operations bring with them huge environmental and social risks, which are mostly deliberately ignored by profit-seeking companies. The project began when we learned that in 2011, the Canadian multinational company Nautilus Mineral Inc. was granted an initial mining license in Papua New Guinea. This will make Papua New Guinea the first country in whose territorial seabed mining will take place. The targeted location is the mineral-rich area of Solwara 1, which was discovered by Australia's Commonwealth Scientific and Industrial Research Organization in 1996. Companies like Nautilus Minerals directly target the governments of resource-rich yet economically deprived countries in the South Pacific as well as actually the Azores Islands off the coast of Portugal. And they target these governments for mining deals. And post-colonialism, the economic situation of countries such as Papua New Guinea is often dire. International corporations exploit their desperation with short-term promises of economic benefits and misinformation about the extent of environmental and social risks that the mining operations bring with them. In the case of Papua New Guinea, the government proceeded with the mining deal without the citizens' consent. Marine Penjueli, coordinator of the Pacific Network on Globalization and activist against deep sea mining, relates concerning the situation in Papua New Guinea, and I quote her here. There was very little understanding about the potential impacts. There was an overemphasis on the potential economic benefits. So the legislations were set up under the broad narrative that seabed mining was considered small risk, very high return. During the research for the project, Armin spent time with marine scientists in their labs, interviewed experts on the jurisdiction of the sea at the International Seabed Authority in Jamaica, visited the United Nations headquarters in New York during the 2017 international conference dedicated to the future of the ocean, and he met with environmental activists in Papua New Guinea. Over the course of our three-year collaboration, we traced the frameworks that administer, permit, and contest ocean exploitation, the intricate networks of power and the inequalities and inequities they produce and maintain, as well as the codependencies and effects on material, immaterial levels. The exhibition was shown in 2018 at the CNR ISMAR in Venice, which is the Institute of Marine Sciences of the National Research Council in Italy. It consisted in several videos, including a lecture presentation of 4 hours, running in parallel to the exhibition, and this part was mainly intended for scientists working at the institution, as well as for people who really wanted to get into depth in these topics. The exhibition also included photographs, a sound piece recorded together with the anthropologist focusing on the oceans, Stefan Helmreich, as well as various layers of exhibition text. And again, we also shared with the people who shared their research with us the material to make it useful and accessible to them in their own work, for instance, activist work. At a tipping point for ocean ecologies, the project wove an intricate network of the technocratic entanglement of industry, science, politics, and economics at the new frontier of ocean excavations. The exhibition venue in Venice was key to be able to communicate with the scientific community as well as with the art and architecture world and policy makers and other decision makers. And again, it was key for us to share the material also with our collaborators. So in this way, the exhibition exceeded the sort of art and academic world and also seeped into life and into these activist spaces. I will not go further into depth with this project, but you can ask me questions, and there is in fact also this the book that you can consult if you would like to know more. And I will leave you with a couple of images by Joan Jonas from an exhibition that we did also in Venice a couple of years back. And to conclude, I want to just summarize and say that as the Anthropocene unmoors apparent certainties, Western epistemologies based on the separation of knowing and the known are becoming increasingly untenable. The oceans flood not only our homes and exhibition spaces, but also dissolve divides between inside and outside, calling for curatorial and artistic responses to address this. Such responses are urgently needed, not least because the current moment evokes anxiety requiring new imaginaries. Tidalectics envisions responsible forms, and the word is divided here, responsible and responsible forms of art making and curating that reimagine models of exhibition making and art practice that originate from the Holocene. Tidalectic curating and art making goes beyond the art field to intersect with other disciplines, be they sociology or marine biology. It takes its cues from natural processes, such as the ebb and flow of the tides. It remembers as much as it dissolves incomplete repositories of knowledge, and it enables processes without knowing where they might lead. It makes room and changes for non-Western practices of knowing and deeply changes paradigms and structures. It listens to the expertise from ocean users and ocean dwellers, both human and non-human, and their embodied experiences. It swims with non-humans, both organic and inorganic, and considers itself as part of the ecotone from which it arises. Tidalectic art and art making drips and splashes, dives and emerges. It comes with wet feet and leaves with wet hair. Thank you.